It's interesting that Tchaikovsky, at the age of 53, already spoke of himself in terms of old age. But in fact, it's as close as he got. 9 days after conducting the Sixth Symphony's first performance, Tchaikovsky was dead. And well over a century later, the cause of his death remains a matter of the most heated controversy. According to tradition, he died of cholera after drinking a glass of unboiled water in a restaurant. According to gossip, subsequently buttressed by scholarly evidence, he committed suicide. Various possible motives have been cited, all of them connected in one way or another with his homosexuality. But both versions beg a number of questions, most of them too long and complex to go into here, and the literature is more confusing than helpful. In one of the most widely read and authoritative books on Tchaikovsky, the author writes, "That Tchaikovsky committed suicide is beyond dispute." Not so. It's been very persuasively disputed with a battery of scholarly documentation. And why should Tchaikovsky have committed suicide when he was at the very peak of his powers and his popularity? More than that, despite the gloominess of the Sixth Symphony, he was in generally high spirits and had just completed what he regarded as his best piece. And why would he have chosen a method to die which would inflict on him days of agonizing pain? It's been suggested that he poisoned himself with arsenic, but there's nothing to suggest that he was a masochist, and precious little evidence that he was ever really suicidally minded. The one story we have, his supposed attempt to contract pneumonia by wading into the river Moscow, is based on a single and unreliable source. But according to the most widely accepted account of his death, he committed suicide not because he wanted to, but because he was ordered to. The story goes like this. A letter was written to the Tsar by a Duke Stenbock Fermor reporting Tchaikovsky's supposed seduction of his young nephew. The man entrusted with the delivery of this letter, fully aware of its contents, had been a contemporary of Tchaikovsky's at the School of Jurisprudence. The man, Jacobi by name, was appalled at the dishonour this would bring on the school and its old boys, and decided not to deliver the letter to the Tsar at all. Instead, he convened a special, secret court of honour, to use his phrase, composed of 7 former school friends of Tchaikovsky. They then summoned Tchaikovsky to a hearing, so-called, and, in order to save the school from scandal, they required him, their term, to take his own life. So far, so plausible, I suppose. But would the most famous Russian composer in history, then at the peak of his career and with friends in high places in many countries, meekly have accepted this verdict and done as he was told? True, he passionately loved Russia and often felt acutely homesick when he was abroad. Exile, even in luxury, might have proved intolerable, but wasn't it worth a try? If it did prove more than he could bear, then he could commit suicide. And in any case, would the Tsar have unleashed a scandal? Homosexuality in Russia was commonplace, though not openly acknowledged, and the courts appear generally to have turned a blind eye to it. And so might the Tsar have, especially in the case of Tchaikovsky, one of the brightest jewels in the Russian crown. In fact, many of the Tsar's own relatives and highest officials were also homosexual. Well, whatever the truth, and we're unlikely ever to know it, the end result was the same. Tchaikovsky was dead, and the music lovers of 3 continents struggled to believe it. The Tsar himself insisted on meeting the burial costs and instructed the Directorate of the Imperial Theatres to organize the funeral. A magnificent service was held in the Kazan Cathedral in St. Petersburg. 6,000 mourners filled the church, while 60,000 thronged the streets outside. The Tsar didn't himself attend. That would have been unprecedented, but he sent an elaborate wreath of white roses, complementing the white cassocks of the clergy as they marched in front of the hearse, which was drawn by 6 horses. At 5 in the afternoon, on Thursday, the 28th of October, 1893, Tchaikovsky's coffin was lowered into the grave at the cemetery of the Alexander Nevsky Monastery, not far from the graves of Borodin and Mussorgsky. His life was over, The life of his music was just beginning. He may have been too modest to entertain the thought, but nothing would have given him more joy than to realize that well after a century later, his works would still be played and loved by many thousands, many millions of music lovers around the world. He was a man who could well have written of his entire life's work what Beethoven wrote on the first page of his Missa Solemnis: "From the heart, may it go to the heart."